Hello all, this is Dr. Alsop, and we are going to really get into some of the branches of the maxillary artery located in the infratemporal fossa, as well as some superficial veins in the infratemporal fossa region. So let's not waste any time and get right into it. We're going to start with the veins because they are the most superficial and one typically needs to remove them to get a clearer view of the deeper arteries and certainly in terms of the mandibular nerve. So this whole complex right here, I'm just going to circle the general region, is going to be part of the pterygoid plexus of veins, which is a collection of small veins in the general location of the pterygoid muscle. So it's going to drain that particular region. You can see these are quite small, but it's quite dominant in this region, this plexus of veins, and all of these smaller branches will coalesce or join to form the maxillary vein, which you can see right here. Now, the maxillary vein is generally larger in diameter, but it is pretty short. It will fairly quickly join with the superficial temporal vein to form the retromandibular vein. Now, in order to better see the maxillary artery and its branches, the veins just discussed needed to be removed in this particular dissection. So we are left looking at this pretty large maxillary artery right here. Recall that the maxillary artery is a terminal branch of the ECA. Remember what that stands for? External carotid artery, and it's the larger terminal branch of the external carotid artery. The maxillary artery is divided into three parts based on its relationship with the lateral pterygoid muscle, specifically this inferior head of the lateral pterygoid muscle. The first or mandibular part, which we will start with, is going to be kind of deep to the mandible and posterior to the lateral pterygoid. The second part, or the pterygoid part, is going to be adjacent to the lateral pterygoid muscle. So it's either going to be located superficial, as it is here, or deep to the lateral pterygoid. And the third, or pterygopalatine part, will be anterior medial to the lateral pterygoid. But really, that name change doesn't occur until you get towards that pterygomaxillary fissure, which is going to be in this general region over here. And so that's how it's entering to the pterygopalatine fossa. So it's really not, you don't get many of those branches until you're headed into that region. So we're going to focus on the branches of the first and the second parts in this video because we're really focused on the infratemporal fossa region, and save the third part for a video for another session. So let's start with the first part. This is going to be deep to the neck of the mandible, which has been removed here. You can see a little bit left of the mandibular condyle, so it'd be right around this region. All of the branches of the first part of the maxillary artery will traverse bone, so it's heading for some form of foramen. And the first two branches are exceptionally small. Typically, the first one, which I'm going to draw an arrow to right here, is going to be the deep auricular, with the second branch, very close to the deep auricular, which is the anterior tympanic. So you can see these are extremely small muscles, they would be very small muscles. They're very small arteries right here in this region. The deep auricular will pierce the external acoustic meatus, whereas the anterior tympanic artery will actually pass through the petrotympanic fissure to get into the skull. And remember that petrotympanic fissure is also how the chorda tympani will exit the skull to get to the infratemporal fossa. Okay, moving a little more distally, you're going to have the middle meningeal artery, which I just outlined right here. This will enter the skull via the foramen spinosum to supply the dura mater, so that's where it's getting that meningeal in its name. And then the last branch of the first part is going to be the only one that really is descending. The rest you could see are ascending, and that's going to be the inferior alveolar artery, which will accompany the inferior alveolar nerve, or IAN, into that mandibular foramen. So you can kind of see it's heading into the bone, into that mandibular foramen. All right, moving to the second part of the maxillary artery, which you can see on this donor is going to be superficial to the inferior head of the lateral pterygoid muscle. All the branches of the second part will supply muscles of mastication and surrounding structures. So remember, we have those four muscles of mastication, the masseter, the temporalis, and the pterygoid muscles. You'll also have the closely associated buccinator muscle right here, which is innervated by the facial nerve, but it will have some of its supply from one of these branches of the maxillary artery. Okay, usually the most proximal branch of the second part is the masseteric artery, which is the case here. Draw a nice M on this. And this particular dissection, it's been cut pretty close to the source, so you don't really see where it's going, and that makes sense because the masseter muscle has been completely removed in this dissection. This artery will accompany the masseteric nerve through the mandibular notch to enter the deep portions of the masseter muscle, so we've seen that in some other videos. The next branch that you can locate, and I'm just going to draw a line here, is the posterior deep temporal artery, which you can see ascending to reach the deep side of the temporalis muscle, which has been reflected up just so you can really see some of these branches. And this artery often gives off a varying number of pterygoid branches, which you can see here and here. And it's important to note, though, that the pterygoid branches there can be branches in many of these arteries in this region. You can actually see one right here coming directly off of the maxillary artery. Continuing on, you can see the anterior deep temporal artery, also going to supply the temporalis muscle. And lastly, you're going to have this artery right here, which is the buccal artery. And the buccal artery is going to accompany the buccal nerve, which you can see right here. Sometimes this is referred to as the long buccal nerve, into the buccal fascial space. So this artery is actually going to supply some of the blood supply to the buccinator muscle. We know that the long buccal nerve will not innervate the buccinator because that's going to be efferently innervated by a facial nerve branch. So this long buccal nerve is going to be a sensory branch for this region. You can see actually that the buccal artery in this particular donor is coming off quite anterior medial to the lateral pterygoid muscle, but it is still typically considered a branch of the second part of the maxillary artery. Really, branches of the third part, like I had mentioned before, don't really start occurring until you get to that pterygomaxillary fissure, which is quite medial. So those are the main branches of the first and second parts of the maxillary artery. As always, please take time to try to identify these structures on your own. And if you have any lingering questions after doing that, please do always feel free to reach out with any questions. Thank you for your time and attention.